Alright guys, it's Charbox Reviews, coming at you guys with my review for the True Detective Season 3, Episode 8, finale episode tonight. Alright, so guys, I just finished watching the finale for True Detective Season 3. Really, really hyped for this one. The whole week, kind of throwing around theories with you guys, especially on the last review. I really do appreciate the support on that. But a ton of people commenting on it, you know, giving our theories and stuff like that. And, you know, I was a bit disappointed with this finale. I'm going to be honest. I thought it was a really great episode. I think one of the best episodes of the season. But in terms of a finale with, you know, stuff that we were expecting, and of course with it being so anticipated this entire week, or at least for me, I just found it that it was lacking that kind of next level that I was expecting from True Detective, especially given season one, right? And so, you know what, I found this one disappointing, but I'd love to hear your thoughts of it. Of course, we'll go through a whole recap. This one might be actually a little bit long, because I do want to talk about everything, want to touch on everything, because this is the last review I'll be doing for the season. And yeah, so we'll do a recap, of course, then I get to my rating, favorite character, and then maybe some final thoughts on the season and some of my theories to see if they came true or not. But I'd love to hear your guys' thoughts on this one. Let me know what you thought of the finale. Let me know what you thought of the season now that you've seen the finale and how it all has wrapped up. I'd love to hear your thoughts. It is over. The theories are probably over with now. They didn't leave a lot to the imagination, per se, with this finale, and so, I'm pretty sure that we're all good for that, but I'd love to hear your thoughts. Also, if you like the review, please leave a like, and consider subscribing to the channel. Would really appreciate it as well. So, without any further ado, let's get into this one. Like I said, a little bit of a longer recap, but I do want to talk about everything. So, first, we start off with Wayne in Hoyt's car. We basically come back right where we left off, which I wasn't sure that we may even see this scene, but we do. So, anyways, Michael Rooker as Hoyt was awesome. I love anything Michael Rooker is doing. Honestly, all of his last projects have been awesome. Of course, Walking Dead is where I know him from for the first time. But so Wayne is in Hoyt's car. They're driving through a back road in a forest, right? So, you know, kind of building up that suspense already, showing that they're kind of going to a bad place here, right? Wayne's kind of denying right now at first. He's like, you know, what's this all about and everything? Hoyt says, you got in the car, you know what this is about, right? And so Hoyt's not really, you know, he's kind of ready to cut the bullshit and just get to the point, right? And Wayne's kind of trying to dance around this whole scene, right? And so they get out then, they're alone, and they start walking down to the forest. They actually walk out to this cliff with actually a really great view. But then they start talking about Julie Purcell, of course, and everything going on, right? And so Hoyt says, my man, Harris James, I want to know what happened to him. He's basically denying anything that happened. He said, oh, I don't know what happened to him, right? Says he has no idea where he might be. Hoyt tells him that he saw them follow them from the plant on the security cameras. So some people obviously were speculating last week, well, how did Hoyt see them? How does Hoyt know, right, that they killed Harris James? And so he watches them on the security cameras in this case, and then obviously, we find out a little bit later that he has a GPS tracker on Harris. And so that is why or how he knew exactly what had happened, right? So Hoyt tells him to stop lying. And he says, you want to, oh yeah, sorry. So then Wayne says, Mr. Hoyt, you want to tell me about Julie Purcell? Right, so Hoyt's kind of, you know, blaming him for Harrison talking about this. And, you know, Wayne kind of turns the tables on him. Hoyt tells him that he's in the dark on it as well. He knows just as much as he does on this. He reveals to Hayes that he has a GPS, like I said, on James, and knows exactly where he is, so he can go with a shovel and dig him up. So he knows pretty much exactly what happened, right? So Hayes tells him that they should swap confessions. Hayes will tell him about Harris James, and then Hoyt can tell him about Julie Purcell, right? And basically, Hoyt just denies that. He says the best thing you could do for the girl is leave her in peace, right? Kind of stop looking for her, just let her go. And turns out he actually is right. So I think he'd actually, in the scene, I think he knew exactly what had happened. And I don't think he really truly had any malintent. I think the whole time in this story, is he wanted the best for his daughter. And I think, you know, when she passed, as we found out, I think he truly did want the best maybe for Julie or Mary or whatever going forward. And so I think he's being honest here, is that the best thing to do with for the girl is leave her in peace. I think he's being honest there. So then he says that he can practically guarantee that nobody is looking for her right now. And again, just kind of showing that he knows the truth about it, right? And then he leaves Hayes out there, says that he can find his own way back. And he tells him that making Hoyt feel threatened would not be a very good idea. Because then Wayne, of course, threatens to go and question him again later on duty. And of course, Hoyt doesn't take too kindly to that. So again, it's not as big of a scene as I thought it would be, though. We get some threats here and there, and then Hoyt kind of ends it off and ultimately says, threatening me is not a good idea, right, for him. But it wasn't a big scene, not a really, monumental scene that changed everything. And that's what I thought it would be going in, but it actually ended up just being a quick 3 to 4 minute scene that wasn't actually that impactful. It was basically just Hoyt asserting his power, Wayne kind of being told off, and that was about it. And we also found out that Hoyt, he's drinking whiskey or something like that during the day and just walking with him. So he doesn't seem like he is too, in a good place himself. And so that might factor into that one as well. But anyways, kind of a disappointing scene there to begin with. And that, to me, really set in play the disappointment for the rest of the whole episode. So then we get 1980s, the scene basically explaining that how Hayes got sent to the public information job. We kind of knew, why this happened. But again, a very nice kind of filling in the gap a little bit for us with a couple details. Basically, the story was published right by Amelia with an anonymous source, which obviously kind of drew back to him. So the AG basically wants him to make a statement of his own, basically signing that the story was misrepresented. It misrepresented his facts and the stuff he told Amelia. And he ultimately declines to do it. He says that he's not going to do it. Roland even tries to get him to do the statement to keep his job, as Roland was the one who kind of argued for him to let the AG even give him that opportunity. But Hayes ultimately declines. He denies that the facts were misrepresented and all that stuff. So really kind of an interesting decision here. He still remains skeptic about the hasty conviction of Woodard. I believe those are the words from the AG, the hasty conviction of the Woodard. We see that he is really, and I think Roland is too. He just has a different approach. But we see that Hayes is really a good guy. Deep down, he has a heart, and he is really out there seeking good. And he really did want to find the truth. And I think this is a perfect example that whereas he could have just signed this and stayed on the department for years, but instead he chose to go to public information and basically destroy his career at that point. So there you go. Then we get to 2015. This was an awesome scene. This was just insane. So Roland and Wayne go to the Hoyt estate to take a look at the part of it where that lady a couple episodes ago or last episode told them that nobody was allowed to go. Right. And so they go to this estate, which is actually not abandoned, but no one is living there right now. And so they go to this place. And I love this line here. Wayne says, "What if someone catches us?" And Roland says, "We're old and confused." Right. That was one of my favorite lines of the episode. That was just really great. Roland was honestly a fan favorite in this one. A lot of really great writing for him in this one. Dialogue and also his kind of story. The bar fight scene. That was awesome. Right. So they quickly find the basement as they go to this Hoyt estate here. The basement, as I like to refer to it as, right? They go towards the door to the pink room, right? And we saw this already with Tom. And so they open up the door to the pink room. And wow. So obviously we see what Tom saw when he looked in there, which was the kind of drawing on the wall with the Mary and then Isabel, and I think there was the one of Junius, right? I think that's his name, Junius, right? Junius. And so you see those three on the wall, and I think that's what Tom saw, although I don't think we ever get, clarification or confirmation for that, but I think that is what we're led to believe. So Tom saw that mural. And then Roland says, as they kind of regroup, this is where they kept her, Wayne that says, this is where they kept her, and this is where she ran away from. Everything is kind of coming full circle to them right now, and then Roland says, 25 years, and we just all this goddamn time. What the hell were you doing, right? He looks at Wayne. What the hell were you doing, right? 25 years, this room was here. And you notice how easily they find this thing. Like, it literally takes them, what, 2 days since they've gone back together in 2015? They go to the estate, and they find the pink room. So, it, you know, it really is. I mean, 25 years, and they never thought to look there. It's just incredible how that all worked, right? And obviously, he's questioning Wayne here, and Wayne says he had a family, and that's the reason he kind of cites for not going deeper, and for not, you know, trying to look for, example, the pink room and find out this case. Obviously, he also felt threatened by Hoyt, but then later in the episode, we see it wasn't really all about Hoyt, actually. It was more just about Amelia and him going forward as a family. And so, really kind of heartbreaking, emotional scene there where they come across the pink room and it's like they realize that how so many mistakes that they had made along the way and that they could have saved her, and it would have been pretty easy to figure that out, that this room was there. Obviously it's years later, so there would have been Isabel, of course, still living there in the 90s when they went back, and people living there, but still, it would have been pretty easy to find nonetheless. So then we get back to the 90s, we get a nice little scene between Wayne and Amelia, and again, this kind of explains why Wayne never looked for it in the 25 years. So really good order of things here. So he says, there are aspects of my job that are not for sharing. That's what he tells Amelia after getting back from Hoyt, of course. They're at the restaurant, I think. He says, it was a mistake earlier that he said that he would tell her everything, because now he doesn't want to do that. He thinks, like he says, some things are just not for sharing, right? And that, you know, that's just the truth of it. And Amelia, not very happy with this. She's not agreeing. She questions that they should even go forward with their relationship and their family with a big secret like this wedged between them. She even accuses him of seeing another woman or something like that. Hayes kind of, you know, puts that down right away. And then Hayes alludes to them solely being connected due to a dead boy and a missing girl, which ultimately is meaning the case, right? And you know, maybe they don't know each other as well as they thought. That's what's kind of raised in this scene, is that they've kind of just quickly, you know, fell in love and had this family and got married all because of this case, and they've obviously been constantly working on it, talking about it, as Amelia's written this book. Obviously Wayne's been thinking about it in 10 years, but now working in public information, and now back with Roland at this point. So really kind of seeing their relationship and how it was never really all fleshed out, in terms of them, you know, actually falling in love. It was perhaps maybe just because of this case. And then he tells her that they tanked the case again, the same as 80. So again, just showing how he feels about the department. He says maybe they should both quit from the case and move on, meaning that she doesn't write the sequel to her book and that he quits the police department. And this essentially, right, explains why. It's because for their sake as going forward as partners, as a marriage, as parents in this family, he thinks that quitting the case is just going to improve both of them, in the future. And that's ultimately the decision they both make. She never writes the sequel and he quits the department. And that's also why Roland is so pissed off at him in 2015, is because he kind of just left abruptly with no reasoning. And that's exactly what it seemed to him. But obviously, we see that it was for the betterment of Wayne and Amelia's family. So it wasn't even necessarily because of Hoyt and his threats. It was mainly just because Wayne and Amelia, Wayne wanted this relationship to continue, and he knew to continue it, they had to quit this case. They had to leave it behind, and so that was a great scene there explaining that. So then we see this was basically the reveal, the reveal of everything except the kind of twist ending, if you will. Whereas in 2015 they go to meet Junius Watts, so they track him down, the one-eyed man, of course. Of course, they track him down. They get to his house with guns. They stand behind him. Just so funny because, I mean, at this point, they're all old men, right? But they're still kind of acting like they're, the youngins in 80, right? With the guns at him and all that stuff, right? So then the quote is for Junius. He says, I've been waiting for you all since the night you saw my car. I probably shouldn't have drove off, but you had that baseball bat. So confirming that he was the one watching them on the street. You know, he was watching Hayes. Crazy stuff, right? Just kind of an awesome connection there. That was one of the biggest kind of twists or surprises that I had in this episode. So anyways, they bring him into his house, and then we basically get the reveal of everything. So Junius, I'll try to go through this quickly. So Junius says he helped in the raising of Hoyt's daughter, Isabel, then explains the accident where they lost her child. I believe it was Isabel's husband and her daughter that they lost in this accident. So Harris James helped keep the event quiet for them, with Isabel getting in an accident through her grief. So after that accident, she got in another little car wreck because of her grief and her, you know, kind of sickness, as Junius says. Harris helped them cover that one up. And so that obviously comes back later, right? So then we learn that Isabel admired Julie the one day at some meeting or something like that at the Hoyt's place, because, of course, Lucy worked for Hoyt Foods. So, you know, Isabel admired Julie, and then later Lucy gave them permission to play with her daughter, giving Isabel and Junius, of course. So Isabel then, we learned, wanted to adopt the little girl as she was much better with her in her life. She was doing a lot better with a daughter and something to focus on again. And one of the days, they were playing hide and seek out in the forest, as they usually did. Isabel kind of made her move, right? And so she tries taking Julie, starts calling her Mary, right, by her new name. And of course, Will starts fighting back, though, in this scene. He fights back against, you know, Isabel trying to take Julie. And at this point, she kind of just, you know, pulls Julie away, and he falls back, accidentally hits his head on the rock that kills him. He dies from hitting his head on that rock where we saw the blood on beforehand. So everything's kind of coming full circle here. Junius then lies to Julie in the scene, says that, you know, her brother's fine, you know, he just hit his head and it was just an accident. And then later he puts him in the praying pose in the cave. And then he tells Roland and Wayne it was just a bad accident. Pretty crazy to say that, right? It's like, it was just a bad accident. Well, you know, a boy died. So, you know, maybe it was an accident. But, you know, for him to say that, obviously, Roland and Wayne not taking too kindly to that either at that point. Anyways, so then he says that he called Harris, who helped them out before, right, to basically help them out now and basically cover up. He took the backpack and shirt to the Woodard scene and implicated him instead, planted the evidence, which we all have kind of knew already. I think it was Wayne who said, what about the mother Lucy? Right? And how did that all go? So basically we find out that Harris gave her a lot of money to let Isabel keep Julie and for her to basically keep quiet about it. And of course that explains then why, of course, Lucy wrote the note or the, you know, that note to Tom, which we also know already. That she kind of knew what exactly was going on, but she couldn't talk about it because of all this money that she got given there by Harris. So, you know, she's kind of forced into, you know, letting her daughter go to Isabel, which was very emotional there for a mother at this point. You know, it's just insane. But anyways, and also she finds out about Will dying, right? So she has to keep that secret as well. And we see her just broken down in that scene with Harris. So, yeah, very, very unfortunate. So then we get Isabel brings Julie to the pink room. Junius says that she was very happy there for a couple of years and thought truly, you know, she believed that she was Isabel's daughter for a little bit. And then he found out that Isabel had been feeding the little girl lithium since she was age 10. That's kind of the big twist in this whole thing, right? Is that she was being basically laced, her drinks were being laced with lithium since she was age 10. And that's what Isabel was also on at the point. So even before they took her, and that is why that she was, you know, she wasn't sure about her own history, right? Is that she was even being given lithium before they even kidnapped her and took her. And, you know, very, very sad. So, then a quote from, I believe it was Roland, and he said, she'd been drugged half her life and told some false fairy tale by this woman. And that's exactly what happened to her, right? So Junius then tells them that as the years went by, Julie started asking questions, right, as she grew up about her past and her brother, you know, what happened. It's like, yeah, right? Like, especially as you grow older, I mean, this is just in every case. You know, you kind of think back to things and you wonder, you ask those big questions, right? And that's exactly what happened here. And so with Isabel being sicker, I guess she kind of fell back into the sickness again. Junius basically helped her run away by leaving the door unlocked one day, gave her a map, basically, with a place to go where they would meet, and then that, you know, he would help her, right? And it turns out that she never showed up there in that place, and he's been looking for her ever since. And that exactly explains the book reading scene where he came in looking for her, and that's exactly what he was doing. He was just looking to see where Julie was. And then he says that Isabel had another breakout then after Julie escaped, and that she then ended up dying in her sleep. And then tells them about the runaway program that told him in 97 that Julie had been staying there under the name Mary July. And then we see that scene play out. So just to summarize this, I mean, Isabel, obviously a horrible person. And to be honest, I mean, she is, I mean, obviously Junius deserves a lot of blame, and you know, he's definitely criminally liable. I mean, you know, he obviously was essentially, I don't know about him being the procurer. I think that's what they alluded to last episode. But he definitely should have obviously went to police about this, right? And he didn't. So anyways, but Isabel, I think, deserves almost all the blame in this situation. But then again, she probably wasn't even in the right mindset. She probably isn't even criminally responsible at this point because of her sickness and her being on lithium constantly. So just a really kind of horrible, horrible situation that happened here. And it's really unfortunate. And obviously, Isabel is dead, so there will be no justice served, or perhaps justice has been served already. So just a really, you know, tough situation. So then we see that Hayes and West go to this, basically go to this place where this program is run at this church. And the woman, the nun there, the woman tells them that she had HIV. Julie had HIV when she came in, and that they tried to take care of her, but after a few months, she died. Right? Like, crazy, right? So then they visit the gravestone, Mary July on it, and it's just, you know, a chilling moment here because she's dead, right? And they missed their opportunity, right? Or as so we think. So then Junius says that he was too late. Something she did out there on her own got her real sick, and that is what led to her having HIV and dying, right? And obviously Junius believes this story from the nun, so then Wayne saying, no matter what they do, it's too late now. Right, they missed their chance, and it's all too late because she is now dead. Junius says that's why he waited outside his house to tell him the truth about what happened, but he could never get the nerve. So that's why he was watching him in the car, is that he was trying to go to his house, trying to go to his door to tell him the truth, and he just never could get the nerve, and that's why he was outside for so long. Basically, he asks them to take him in. He tells them that they can't, that he can't live with this any longer. He either wants to be, I guess, killed or taken in custody, and he wants to be punished for his actions. And a really just great, satisfying thing here is Hayes replies, "Sorry, but we don't have that authority anymore." And they basically just leave him. They basically just leave him there, right? They tell him that he has to live out his life. And you know, and he's just got to live with it. And I, to me, that's what he deserves. You know, would he have the same kind of guilt and the same feeling in a prison? Probably. But you know, as they say, they don't have the authority. I mean, he's being realistic. They're not cops anymore, so they can't just arrest them. But anyways, so I thought this was really fitting and satisfying, just to see this guy now live out with his guilt and you know, just have to live with it. And that's just what he's gonna have to do, and he's done it for 25 years, so it's not like, you know, it's just suddenly now, right? And then Roland says, if you don't want to live with it, don't. And he looks at the guns in his house, kind of suggesting that maybe he should you know, take his own life if that's the case. So anyways, so that's basically the end of Junius in this one, but he revealed a lot to us and basically told us all the events of what happened. All right, so then, of course, this is kind of overlaid as Junius is talking about it, right? We see this kind of stuff play out. And so then we see them standing at the gravestone, basically acknowledging, because, of course, they think that Julie's dead and she's buried there, and basically acknowledging that they failed her and that they should have done better. And ultimately, that's what it is. I mean, you know, ultimately, it's not their fault for what happened, but could they have done better? Yeah, right? They really should have. And again, the fact that they found this pink room so easily now in 2015 and have unraveled the details of this case so easily within a couple days, or you know, 3 days of meeting each other again, it really does seem like they could have done better, and they maybe should have. And of course, very emotional, though, at this point, because they know it's too late. They can't do anything now. And then, of course, so they head out from this gravestone, and they talk to Mike, who who basically has a daughter, Lucy, who almost runs into Wayne there, and on their way out, they say hi to this Mike guy. You know what? This was the kind of big twist to end off the episode, and to me, this was so predictable. I mean, the daughter named Lucy, Mike. Of course, I heard a little bit about this theory as well, with this Mike guy being with Julie. This was, to me, really predictable, to me, it was not a big reveal later on in the episode. I knew right away when I saw Mike and this daughter, Lucy, that was the case. I really had no doubt. But anyways, so that's a little bump in there. And then we see back at Wayne's house, they start packing up all the evidence as they think the case is done, right? They find out Julie's dead, she's been dead for a while, and that there's nothing more to do, right? They basically found out the details, they found out the truth, and it's over, right? But as Roland says, neither of them feel any closure. And it's really unfortunate, too, because, again, you know, there's really no justice left to be had. Junius is, you know, they just kind of leave him there to live out with his guilt. Of course, Isabel has died. She's long been dead. And, you know, there's not really any justice to be served. And, of course, they really can't help Julie anymore because she's dead. So really an unfortunate moment there, especially as Roland states, no closure. So then Roland offers to stay over there at the house for a few nights, a few nights a week with Wayne from now on. Just a really kind of nice, brotherly, I would say, relationship here that has been formed now in 2015 again. Of course, this has to do with the memory, right? Roland wants to be there for him. And, just a kind of a really nice kind of heartwarming scene bouncing back from them at Julie's gravestone, right? And then he also tells him that his daughter's coming home to see him the next day and that they're having a little bit of a reunion dinner together. And so that is really awesome, too. So then we see the next day in the morning, Wayne wakes up, and also very ominous scene there as well when Roland leaves the door and Wayne is kind of just standing there alone and he turns the lights out and whatever. They were really hinting that Wayne may, kill himself or some. Honestly, I was getting those thoughts. They're playing that really creepy music and he was kind of alluding and, you know, he hugged Roland very emotionally too. So it really seemed like something was going to happen there, but of course it doesn't. So the next day, Wayne reads a page of Amelia's book, which basically falls down on the ground. By the way, a huge coincidence here. I don't love how this played out, but anyways. So the page in the book talks about the Mike boy from school and how his father owns a lawn care business that works at this church, right? So it all comes full circle. The man, of course, that he just met at the runaway shelter. So he says that he always, Amelia is kind of asserting that he always wanted to marry Julie in the future. And so that's a big thing as well. So then we see that Amelia visits him in a hallucination behind him, the last hallucination of the season, which was really great, and basically suggests that the nuns covered up her death by telling a false narrative to protect her from the bad people that were still looking for her, of course, in 90. Obviously then Wayne thinks back to the little girl he saw earlier, and of course Mike, and then he starts piecing together things, and basically figures out that was her daughter, and he says, my God, right? So everything's kind of come full circle. Of course, this was kind of the big twist to everything, is that Julie is not dead, and it was all just kind of a cover-up to help her live a better life in the future with Mike, and obviously kind of hide her from all those people that were still looking for her. So anyways, I like the twist, and I liked how it all came together here, but again, kind of predictable to me in this case. But anyways, so we all kind of piece things together. So basically to confirm this, as he doesn't, obviously quite have enough proof or believe it quite yet, he drives to Mike Adruin's, I think that's how you pronounce the name, Mike Adruin's address after getting it on the phone, to basically find out if this is true, that Julie is living with this Mike guy and that is her daughter. So he arrives there, basically sees Julie and her daughter out on the yard. And we basically get the reveal, like, that is Julie and she's living with Mike. you know, happily ever after, if you will, with the daughter. So, and then he basically, in the car, calls his son Henry and tells him that he's lost all of a sudden. And it really happens suddenly here. And Henry suggests that he talks to someone around him to get, you know, the location of where he is. And he goes to talk to Julie. Wow, right? And tells her that he's lost. She tells him the address. He basically relays it to Henry. And, you know, he says that they'll come and get him. Just wait at your car, essentially, right? And so then Julie offers him some water. So then he stays for a minute, awkwardly looking at them. And as he takes a sip of that water, to me, and this wasn't obvious, but to me, I think in this scene, right when he sips that water and kind of awkwardly looks at both of them, I think he actually realizes. I think his memory comes back and he realizes exactly who they are, but he doesn't want to admit it or question them because he recognizes that they're living a good life now and that they're kind of, you know, gone. But to me, that's what I interpreted that scene as, that he actually, at that point, at that moment in time, figured out that that was Julia and her daughter, and that he basically just didn't reveal to them because he didn't want to basically ruin what they had there. And so, yeah, but then he leaves and says goodbye, nothing much else. And then, he, of course, he looks kind of back at them again. And I think that was just a really confirmation of, you know, he knew. He knew at that point what was going on. So, anyways, but also really ironic as he forgets just as he found them, right? So, I mean, if you're going to go in the scenario that he didn't know them, even when he took that sip of water, like, so ironic. I mean, either way, you look at this, right when he gets to the house, he sees Julia and her daughter, he forgets, and his memory fails him. And that was in the synopsis of this episode, how I think it said Wayne's concept of reality or something like that. And it's true. I mean, his concept of reality has been so construed and that, you know, even then when he finally finds out the truth, he still can't quite comprehend it or understand it because of his memory. And so, you know, obviously, kind of irony coming out in that one. So then let's go over the end of the episode. So basically, he gets home and his daughter is joining them there out on the porch. She drives him home. Really emotional scene there, actually, as she kind of realizes that she hasn't been there for him. And she says, "I even miss you right now," because she realizes that her dad isn't really her dad anymore, or isn't all of her dad, which was actually a really emotional scene there. And again, just another question raised of why wasn't she involved in his life? And that was never really explained, and that's something that I just really don't understand. But anyway, so then Roland is there now, he gets there, and then this was the best visual, I think, of the whole season. I mean, this was incredible. So they basically, from the porch, watch Henry's kids bike off down the road, just like Julie and Will in episode one. I got chills in this scene. That honestly was one of the best visuals, and I give a lot of credit to Daniel Stackham, I think, who was the director of this episode. That just that visual, right, in that exact same kind of angle that they were going for, that was just insane. That was so chilling to me to see that. Of course, nothing happens to the kids, but it's just such a chilling visual there, and a really great job to that. Then we transition to the 80s as he sits in a bar. Basically, Amelia arrives, asks him if he meant what he said before, and she says, "Wayne, what do you want?" And essentially, he apologizes to her for the things that he said to her before. He says he's not himself, but he thinks he wants to marry her. Really great stuff. And then Amelia says they should get home so he can think about how to propose. And then he says, "I ain't messing with you. I don't play." And Amelia says, "No, I know you don't." So just a kind of a nice scene there explaining then how that relationship got recuperated after that big fight scene between them that we saw before. They walk out of the bar together, through the doorway, and into the battlefield at Vietnam as Wayne tracks through the forest, and that is where we leave it. So that is the end of True Detective Season 3. Alright guys, so just to wrap things up here, so my rating for this episode, I'm going to give it a 4.5 out of 5. You know, doesn't seem too low, but for me, compared to the other episodes, that's kind of low. To me, this was a lackluster finale, just in the fact it was a little bit too predictable. I was just waiting and waiting and waiting, especially with an hour and 15 minute runtime, which I felt dragged on a little bit too long. I was just waiting for the big twist to kind of blow my mind on everything, and it didn't come. It just never came for me. I mean, some people may have been really kind of shook at the twist at the end that Julie is still alive and she has her daughter. But to me, that was really predictable, and I just really wasn't surprised at this ending. So for me, and again, like I said off the top, this was a great episode. Don't get me wrong. To me, this is one of the best episodes of the season. But as a finale where we expected something huge, and this was such an anticipated episode, it really disappointed me in that case. But anyways, it is what it is. You know, ultimately, though, it was a good wrap-up to the season, right? Keeping that tone, keeping that theme, staying consistent with what they built for seven episodes, I think it was good there. I did like how it was revealed, though, and basically how Hayes' memory loss impacted basically the whole reveal of the case, in that at the very end, he wasn't able, right, to basically piece things together, or he was, and that he just didn't, you know, claim that he was able to in the scene. But anyways, I did like how it was revealed, liked how they introduced Junius in this one, and then he basically was the one who revealed everything to them. And then also the way that Amelia came in that hallucination, which we've been seeing the whole season, came in and revealed that to Wayne as well. And also, he got it through reading her book, right? And that's something that, again, we saw again and again, that he never read all the way through it. And then he reads the book and he gets the answer to it. So that was really great too. All in all, basically, you know, for me, it was a satisfying finale, again, to wrap up the return to form for True Detective. I do think this was a return to form. Season 2 was definitely an outlier, now we can say, for Nick Pozzolato and True Detective. This season brought them back, but you know what? A better finale, it could have been. It could have been a better finale to wrap this up, but it was satisfying ultimately, and there was a nice little twist in there. And like I said, it was a great episode, but to me, it was just lacking that pop, you know, that pop that would have just, you know, kind of blew my mind. It wasn't there. And so for me, that was a little bit disappointing. But to be honest, it really is a return to form. And season 3, I really enjoyed watching. So my favorite character for this episode, I gotta give it to Wayne Hayes. And you know what? I might do two favorite characters. I'm gonna give it to Wayne Hayes and Roland West for this one. Mahershala Ali and Stephen Dorff. I mean, going into this season, I knew Mahershala Ali was going to give a force of a performance, and he did. His performance throughout this was incredible. I mean, in all three timelines, he was just off the charts. And then Stephen Dorff, I didn't expect that. And also, I mean, Scoot McNairy also deserves an acknowledgement here. Carmen Yogo also very good. But, you know, I mean, Stephen Dorff did an amazing job as well. I think he's going to get really overlooked because of Mahershala Ali, looking back on this season, but he really deserves almost as much credit because he gave an amazing performance in this episode as well as the rest of the season. So both of them were awesome. And without them, I don't know what this season would have been. They really did run with those characters and really brought them to life on the screen. So anyways, they were really great. So just to wrap things up, guys, I just want to thank you guys for coming along with this ride. I know some people, at least by the comments, have been watching, you know, the last 4 or 5 reviews. So I really do appreciate that, guys. You know, a couple of my theories that I wanted to do, I thought the interviewer would be Julie. I thought that would be revealed. That was not the case. I realized that it wouldn't be the case like a couple episodes ago, but I thought, you know, may as well leave it out. And then the cousin as well, with Hoyt, I thought there'd be some involvement with cousin Dan O'Brien, but it doesn't seem like that either. But anyways, for the most part, kind of a predictable finale, although satisfying and, you know, a little bit disappointing. But anyways, really enjoyed this season of True Detective. Thank you guys so much for watching this review. Thank you so much for sticking with me if you did. Really do appreciate it. And subscribe to the channel, likes, comments, views, and all these reviews. Can't thank you guys enough. Please let me know what you thought of this finale. Love to hear your thoughts. So anyways, guys, again, thank you so much for watching this one. And I hope you check out a couple other reviews on my channel. Doing a lot of other shows, including The Walking Dead right now. So I'd love you to go check those ones out as well. But anyways, thank you guys so much for watching this season, True Detective, and my reviews. I will see you in my next video. I got a little this morning. Hey, man. Love is good. I got a little this morning.